Good evening, friends. A warm welcome to each and every one of us who risk to leave their cozy places to be here to worship the Lord. Peace of the Lord be with you. Why don't you share it in the COVID ways, in the new COVID ways after last night? Friends, this evening we have the preacher for the evening, Reverend Fenny, who is the superintendent of the circuit. He's here. I elevated him. I said she. we welcome all the other congregants from the wider parts of the circuit. I could see some of the faces from St. Luke's and the other parts of the circuit. Do we have any visitors this evening? Any visitors? Anyone who feels like a visitor this evening? Wonderful. We all know the COVID protocols. The president spoke last night. I just got the glimpses of his address. I don't know the details, hence you see me without a mask at this distance, but we all know the rules. Friends, the services continues even next week at this time, at the same time, same place, on Wednesdays, 6:30. Listen to these words as we continue to worship the Lord. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your faithful love. Wipe away my wrongdoings according to your great compassion. Wash me completely clean of my guilt. Purify me from my sin. Verse 3 and the last verse for this time. Because I know my wrongdoings, my sin is always right in front of me. And so tonight, friends, as we continue to worship in the Lenten season, the Lord, as we continue to draw closer to him, we will hear as Reverend Fenny will unpack for us, you know, what it means to be the followers of the way who confess their sins to the Lord, who confess sins and acknowledge our wrongdoings around and amongst each other. And so come, let us pray. Loving and gracious God, as we are gathered here, breathe your spirit in the worship for this evening, in all the prayers and the sermon and the singing, O God, may we find and meet you again at this time. We pray even for those who wanted to come here but could not reach here this time. May your spirit sprinkle upon them. And O loving God, even those who are connected in the virtual spaces, we command your spirit to envelop them and connect them with us now and forevermore. Amen. I recognize the other time I forgot. We have a congregation that is seated in their warm seats, in their beds, in their places. Baya welcome, friends. You are welcome. Nam kile kile. And thanks to the worship team as they continue with the worship.
Good evening, everyone. Won't you join with us as we prepare our hearts to worship? Won't you stand? Thank you. Won't you pray with me? So Father God, as we come before you this evening, we are in awe of your name. We know, Lord God, that your name is the name that is above every other name, and that at the end of all of time, every knee shall bow. We know that there is nothing in all of creation that is greater than you, that is greater than your name. That you, through the power of your blood and through the cross, were able to overcome even our deepest sin. Your name is higher than any worry, wider than any fear. Your name is all powerful. And tonight, may we be reminded that we worship a powerful God. A God who is able to move mountains. A God who is able to heal. A God who is able to transform. A God who is able to forgive. A God who is able to change. We pray, Holy Spirit, that as we welcome you into the sanctuary this evening, that you'll begin to move in our hearts and do just that. That you'll touch us, that you'll renew us, that you'll minister deeply to us as we remember your powerful cross, as we remember your name. Amen.
oak tree, bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory,
God, we are so grateful that you are here, that you are moving, that your spirit is at work, and we pray for Reverend Fanny now as he prepares his heart to come and share a word with us, and we pray that your words will become like spirits and that they will transform us, that we may be moved this evening, that we walk out different people who walked in, that you'll shift our perspective and that you'll speak a word of truth into us. And so won't you be with us, and won't you be with the Reverend this evening? Amen. You may be seated.
Can we take a moment of silence? We thank you, Father, for your worship team. Thank you for sparing us this night, protecting us from the day. Some of the things we didn't see, but because of your mighty hand, you have protected and guided us. Be with us as we're going to start your service. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Good evening, everyone. I'm just shaking because this is the place that is not easy for someone like me. Can we all read together Psalm 51? And I'm reading from the New Living Translation. We're going to read the first 11 verses. Psalm 51 from verses 1 to verse 11. It reads like this. Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt, purify me from my sin. I recognize my rebellion. It hurts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. You'll be proved right in what you say, and your judgment against me is just. For I was born a sinner. Yes, from the moment my mother conceived me, but you desire honesty from the womb, teaching me wisdom even there. Purify me from my sins, and I'll be clean. Wash me, and I'll be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy again. You've broken me, now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a local spirit within me. The last verse says, do not banish me from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. This is the word of God. One of the books I sometimes read, especially on certain occasion, the title of the book says, Believe You Can, which is written by John Mason. In one of the chapters, talk about the heading that says, honesty is still the best solution, best policy. The writer on that chapter speaks about the truth that outlives a lie. He continues, says, two half-truths don't make a whole truth. In fact, beware of the half-truth. You may have gotten hold of the wrong one. And lastly, he says, always tell the truth and you never have to remember what you said. During the season of Lent, we return from the wandering ways back to the Holy One, which is God. We take time to watch for the way we conduct on observations and actions that separate us from God. There are so many ways that makes us to be separated from God. Some we know, some we don't know. Some we do, and after when we have been confronted, we start ignoring, saying, no, 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 I didn't do that. As we come today on the Lent period, especially this week 3, where we are going to explore more about the word confession during the Lent period. When I was given this, I received a call from Louise. Then she asked me, will you please be one of us to preach? Then I said, why? Must I say no or yes? Then I remember that, okay, I must not be a spoon. The spoon, when you hold it, it also holds. And because I'm in the authority, I'm a circuit superintendent, I've been asked, then I said, okay, I will do it. And starting then, I was not okay. Especially the word confession. And I look back at my younger age, then I said, wow, what is all about me? But when I was meditating about this word confession, looking at one of the books I'm having, the time I was a student in Rosebank Bible College, which I was taught by the late Dr. Rex Matthew, one of the books is called Every Man a Bible Student, is written by J.E. Church. He says about confession. He says there are two types of confession. A statement or confession of one's faith, or the confession of one's sins and guilt. And he continues to say, in the Bible, confession sin before God is recognized as a condition of forgiveness. Nothing can stop convicted men and women from making a clean breast of hidden sin. But lastly, Finney, one of the writers, says, the natural open confession of a hidden sin to the Lord has always been an accompaniment of a revival and its floodgates, which when opened, let the blessing flow. We all understand that when we confess, the gates often open up and the blessings are coming down. And when I was reading this book, I found out these things that we'll be exploring in this Psalm 51. One of the things says we need to understand that God requires confession of sin, not necessarily on the public. Confession is essentially to God and to Christ as sin barrier. And then he continued by saying, confession to one another and reconciliation. We all understand when we have made some wrongdoing with your brother or your sister, and just saying, I apologize, I confess that I did 1, 2, 3, 4, you become reconciled to one another. And he says again, confession to the assembly. I had a problem with that, but I said, I'll look at it later, not now. Then the third one are saying, confession with the wrong motives has some consequences. I'm sure we all understand that sometimes there are people who confess but with the wrong motives, which does not please God. That's why we receive these words from Psalm, one of the Psalms of David, especially verse 3 and 4. When you read from the Good News Translation, verses 3 and 4, it says, I recognize my faults. I'm always conscious of my sins. I have sinned against you, only against you, and done what you have considered evil. So you are right in judging me. You are justified in condemning me. But when you read from the contemporary English version, it says, I know about my sins. And I cannot forget the burden of my guilt. You are really the one I have sinned against you. And I have disobeyed you and have done wrong. So it is right and fair for you to correct and punish me. We all understand about David. I'm sure Zooks and Luis and Quentin, they've told you about the background of David. But I just want to mention only a few things. He was loved by God and he loved God. But at the same time, he was a terrible sinner. And this psalm is the most moving prayer for pardon, meaning sorry, in the Bible. And one of the things I've realized is that when you do a prayer of confession, you cannot do without faith. Confession without faith is nothing. Those two comes together. As we are in this land journey, we can learn from this prayer of David. And Psalm 51 is the first of the 15 consecutive Psalms in the book of the attributes to David. And it also the fourth of the penitent Psalms, which is Psalm 6, Psalm 32, and 38. And also repentance at the time that Nathan, the prophet, confronted him with his sins. Let's take note of confrontation. When we took our text, the verse that are from the first part, which consists of 1 to 12, which I read only 1 to 11, where the psalmist confesses his guilt, prays for God, for pardon. Then there comes a question in my mind when I was preparing this. How many of us do this when we find guilt, we pray for pardon? How many of us? Or do we wait others to tell us what we have done, something wrong? Or we examine ourselves without being told? But there are few. Some of us wait until they are being confronted. And if you didn't get that chance of being confronted, you just stay as if that nothing has been done wrong. David in this psalm is humbly acknowledges offense, which sometimes it's rare at this time we're living in that people will acknowledge. And it took me back when I was still young. Do you know most at the Gold Cross, this thing was used to pour in the coffee. This part of medicine is now. There's this gold cross we used in the team. You open two holes. What is it? Condensed milk. And then sometimes we steal. And then you start putting in your mouth and start there. And then when they confront, you say no. But when you realize that is gone, what I used to do, I'm going to pour water. But when I'm confronted, I said, no, I didn't do anything. Even sometimes with the sugar. But the problem of the sugar will remain here. And then they start saying, look at the mirror. Then I start saying, look, open with the my eyes. I start saying, I'm sorry. There are one of us, when we are confronted, we start acknowledging, which sometimes is wrong. It took time for David to acknowledge because he was confronted. What if he was not confronted? Ask yourself, what if you are not confronted by something that we have done wrong, which you know it? But David acknowledged his offense. Do we acknowledge our offenses we do to others? Or we shifted the blame. We all know the story of Genesis, Adam and Eve, shifting the blame. It's the woman you gave me, as if that God made a mistake. Some of us, we shifted the blame instead of acknowledging. How I wish that as we journey in this time of Lent, we cannot shift the blame. We acknowledge that we've done something wrong. David pleads with God to cleanse in him a new heart. Because when you acknowledge and say, I've done something wrong, you plead to God and say, Lord, I know my sins. But it's difficult from parents. I'm sorry for those parents. Sometimes they don't want to confess if they've done something wrong to their kids. I know from me. But you'll see with actions. But we are told that we need to acknowledge. How beautiful when we plead to God to cleanse our hearts. As well in this Lent period, let's plead with God to cleanse our hearts and give us a new heart. We all understand when you read 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 to 9, it says, if we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves, not fooling God, and not living the truth. But verse 9 says, but if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse all from all the wickedness. We need to remember these members of Northfield. Confession is essential to God and to Christ as sin bearer. That's why David was doing this. I have to tell you, sometimes we confess to a wrong people and we feel the consequences of confessing to wrong people. Because sometimes when we confess to other people, we're becoming a laughing stock. And we need to be careful. Whom are you confessing to? All I'm asking tonight is that it's God alone who can help you and me. We have seen so many people confessing to other people. And later, when you arrived, people start looking at you with the eyes that are talking, saying, oh, he's the one. That's the failure when we confess to wrong people, not to God. As we're in this period of Lent, let's try by all means to confess to the only one, which is God. Lastly, I love this book of John Mason, which is the title says, Believe You Can. He says in one of the chapters, when you fall, pick something up. And Stanley Jude says, don't be afraid to fall. Because remember, God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And now God loves us. And when we confess and acknowledge our sins, he loves us more. And Stanley Jude says, don't waste energy trying to cover up your failures, because sometimes want to cover up and say, I didn't do this, and come with different strategies. And last one, it says, if you are not falling, you are not growing. But I want to add and say, if you acknowledge, it is good. As we're preparing this to leave this place, let's remember these two things. Confession with the wrong motives also has some consequences. And number two, confession is essentially to God and to Christ as a sin barrier. Let us please and know that as we're going to pray, each one of us, the things that we have done. Some of the things that we have done, we don't want to go back and talk about them. It is good. But God is opening up his arms and saying, here am I. Don't look at your husband. Don't look at your wife. Don't look at your son. God is opening up his arms and saying, you are my son. You are my daughter. We are invited to confess only to God. The one who say, I will never leave you nor forsake you. The only one who will not talk about your confession. I'm inviting you. You've been around confessing to wrong people. God is waiting, and it's not too late to say, Lord, I was going around confessing to the wrong people, but this is my time and you. I'm putting everything into your hands. And the Lord God, I know, he will never chase you away. He will never tell you and say, where have you been before? Why you kept this all along? But the God I know, when you come to him with all of your power and strength and say, Lord, here am I. He will say, I welcome you, my son. And some of the things that are not happening to us is because we are confessing to wrong people. God is waiting for you and me and saying, I'm still waiting for you because you're going around confessing to wrong people. As I am the Lord God, I'm waiting for you. The God I worship, he waited for me to say, now I've been going around, but I give myself to you. Sometimes you look at yourself and saying, some of the things are not going well because you are confessing to wrong people and God is waiting. Don't miss that time. It's not yet over until God says so. Well, I'm inviting, as I'm going to play this song, the Lord is waiting for you and for me. You've been all these years confessing to wrong people. The Lord is waiting for you to open up. He's not going to judge you like me. He's not going to have a cup of tea with friends and saying, so and so has told me this, but my God will just accept you and saying, you are my beloved son. Let's take this moment and listen to this song. It's one of the songs that is in one of the Sotho hymn books, but it's played with instruments here. Let's take a moment of silence. Lord, we thank you for allowing some of the people to come and confront us when we don't want to come up and clean and say we have done 1, 2, 3, 4. Lord, we ask you to raise people like Nathan when we go astray, so that your kingdom can benefit us. Lord, we come to you with a thanksgiving in our hearts, because when we confess to you, you don't talk about our past. You don't talk about where we were. You just open your arms and say, "Welcome, my son. I've been waiting for you. I forgave and forgiven you. And I forget about all the things that we have done." Lord, we thank you that you are the awesome God that does not hold any grudges. Lord, we thank you that you are the great Father. When we confess to you, you open your arms and welcome us. Continue, dear Father, love us, make us happy. We ask all this through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
Thank you so much, Mfundisi Sifeni, for that powerful message this evening. Friends, as we prepare to benedict each other, we have been called, or rather invited and challenged by Reverend Feni this evening, as he shared with us a gift of confession. That confession is a gift. You know, and the confession, if I got his word correctly, you know, confession, it is the door to the restoration of our being back to God. Confession is a door to the grace of God. Confession, as Reverend Feni said, it is actually an immediate gate into the forgiveness. in his words, as he says that when we confess, when we acknowledge, you know, if we live a life that acknowledges our wrongdoing, immediately pardon is given to us immediately without any consideration to the account of our sins. So tonight, as we continue in the week, maybe you could ponder with this question, you know, are you living a life that acknowledges the guilt? Are you acknowledging your guilt? You know, are you living that life? Because in the acknowledgement of the guilt, we find so much fullness of life. There's something that is disengaged. You know, Jesus Christ says that, come to me, all those who are burdened and laden, I'll give you rest. Confession, it is the gate to resting. As we stand to benedict each other, come, let us do benediction together. And now, may the grace of God, love, God, God, with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you, friends. Go safe, sleep well, until we see each other. Same time, same place next week. For those of us who want to have the taste of the convention, it begins on Friday. So if you've got time in the late hours of the morning, you can come in and have a taste of the District Women's Convention that will be here until Sunday. But all the other dishes of spirituality and worship here at Northfield continue as usual. It's just an extra one. So all the other dishes, they are here. So we are to dine. Thank you, friends. Hold me back.